Hey everybody, I just thought I would quickly reprise the presentation that I gave at Digital Zone, and I'm actually using Prezi Video to try and do that too. So it's a kind of combination of reprising the video, but also to use a different technology. So what I was talking about at the conference was navigating the opportunities and threats as a programmatic media buyer in 2020 and beyond. So because the event should have been taking place in Istanbul, this was Merhaba Nisil Sinners, which is hello, how are you, basically. A little bit about me. So just so you know, I've been a media buyer since 1999, so that's 21 years. I haven't really kept kind of like an accurate score of how much money I've spent, but I guess since then I've probably spent about $280 million and that generated about $1.6 billion in sales for the clients I work with. I've also done, for in terms of B2B lead gen, probably about 2.5 million leads for B2B advertisers. And I've been programmatic media buying since about 2009, I guess it was, which is probably around about when this first started. And I'm a big, big fan of performance-based marketing. So take you back to 2009, I actually worked for an ad sales house. I sold, had a kind of an affiliate marketing, affiliate agency. No, actually, what was it called? I had an affiliate network, which I sold to a company called Unanimous. And at the time, Unanimous were in the process of being bought themselves by France Telecom. So they had the Orange network. And I was looking for more sources of traffic for the offers that we were running. Display ads was definitely one of those where we were having a great deal of success. And Unanimous were an ad sales house representing some big brands right across Europe, really. So for me, it seemed like a fairly good sort of match. What became really surprising to me when I actually got inside was that the way in which kind of media was bought it back then was very kind of antiquated. It was very much driven by salespeople. The rate card might be £20 for CPM, but ultimately the rate card would be sold by whatever the sales rep was prepared to get. And quite often it would be Friday night, 4 o'clock, they were looking to go to the pub. So rather than actually negotiating with a buyer looking to kind of buy media, they would almost like give it away. And they had an awful lot of remnant inventory, which went unsold, that basically they just kind of bundled up with a bow and sold it on to somebody else. So for me, it was really just a case of, it was very eye-opening. And at the time, it was when the kind of technology was first coming out. This company, Unanimous, the CEO who's on screen here, he was actually on the board of directors of OpenX, which was, I guess, one of the kind of the leading platforms at the time for that programmatic ecosystem that evolved. So back in the day, I mean, really, if you were buying media, it was a case of on the left-hand side, you've got people kind of buying media, and on the right-hand side, you've got people selling media. And that was kind of like the advertiser and the publisher, and they would kind of work out a deal on what to do. And somehow or other, they would find a way in which to traffic that and kind of track it and report it. What then obviously kind of evolved from there was this kind of massive ecosystem. You've got sort of DSPs, you've got agencies, you've got trading desks, you've got yield optimizers. There's a huge, huge ecosystem that kind of built up. So it was going to be impossible for anyone to try and manage this kind of the way they used to do it. So really that's where the sort of programmatic advertising ecosystem evolved from. By way of a definition, I mean, programmatic advertising is the process of automating the buying and selling of ad inventory in real time through an automated bidding system. Because I think that with the complexity of it all, it would be impossible for sort of one person or a group of people to actually keep track on what needed to be done, when it needed to be done, how it needed to be done. So the kind of the ecosystem and this automation kind of kicked in to enable people to kind of, buy media at scale and have sort of the complexity kind of managed by technology. So this is what we're going to be covering today. We're going to be looking at what the sources of programmatic are, why is it such a kind of rapidly growing area, what your options are around buying media, what are the challenges that you might face in kind of doing so, what ad types you have that are available, what tools, and then at the end there would have been Q&A, but obviously for this particular purpose for the group, I'll answer any questions that you have in the Facebook group itself. So if you have any questions after this, just let me know. So let's talk about what sources that are classed as program. And this will surprise you. I think when I talk to a lot of people, they just assume it's kind of, it's display ads, and that's kind of like your lot. But just by way of kind of, you know, to size the kind of scale of the market, I mean, you can see here, again, this is from eMarketer back in July of this year. And you can see that the total size in 2020 is going to be about $63 billion. And that's about 84% of total digital display ad spend is going to be programmatic, right? And a lot of people go, wow, that seems like really, really high. And that's only going to grow as a percentage, is going to grow from about 84% to about 88%. But in terms of size, it's going to grow from about 63 up to about $94 billion. So I think it's sort of safe to say, even in spite of this sort of pandemic, you know, we're probably going to have a smaller growth than we would have normally had. Normally it's been sort of high double digits, but you know, so I think 2021 and beyond, it should get back to normal. But it includes Facebook, and it also includes Google. So, and really, I mean, Facebook and Google have a duopoly primarily on this programmatic space. So if you are a Facebook ad buyer or a Google ad buyer, guess what? You're kind of going to get a lot of benefit out of this presentation. So let's talk a little bit about this kind of duopoly. So I think it's kind of safe to say that Amazon are now taking a bigger chunk of the pie, right? Albeit it's still a comparatively small piece of the pie, right? So for 2019, their market share was about 7.6%. In 2020, they expect it to be about 8.6%. Personally, I think that might be a little bit higher, because I think Amazon clearly have been one of the beneficiaries of the kind of the pandemic. I think Google and Facebook have probably taken a lot of grief because of some of the kind of challenges of Black Lives Matter and how they've handled hate speech and that sort of thing. I think Amazon have largely been kind of unaffected by that. But I think it's safe to say that this kind of duopoly is about 70% of the overall kind of digital ad spend is consumed between Facebook, Google, and Amazon. And that really means that there's about 30%. So it's still a fairly sizable chunk of real estate that is not kind of covered by those. And we're going to cover some of the kind of sources from that in this video. So really, what I guess the kind of the obvious question is, why is it actually growing as rapidly as it is? Well, I think a lot of the kind of the reason for that is that clearly mobile has become, mobile has landed, mobile is here, right? So way back in sort of 2009, I can actually cite the video, but I did a video and talked about how we were all about video and we were all about mobile, right? And whatever year it was always like, this is going to be the year of mobile. But I think it's safe to say that we are definitely in the era of mobile now. And I think, again, if you kind of think to your own situation, most people are consuming content on not just one device, but two devices. So they might be watching TV and they've also got their mobile in their hand. So if there's ads on TV, they've got their mobile in their hand. So you can still have ads kind of appearing to people on mobiles. If they're sort of traveling, they kind of take their mobile with them. So you're seeing that a lot more of purchases. Originally, the experience on mobile was not so good. I think now the experience on mobile is so much better, and you are definitely seeing people very comfortable with spending money on mobile. And I think if you look at it, I mean, this sort of slide came from a deck that Facebook put out, and they were talking about the way that shopping has advanced, and it's advanced 10 years in the last 2 months, right? So you can see that to get from 5.6% of overall percentage of total retail sales, from 5.6 to 16%, it took 10 years to get to that point, right? And to go from 16% to 27%, so that's a 30% uplift, it only took 2 months. Now, we all know that's been kind of largely caused by, you know, in a lot of cases, lockdowns, and people couldn't get out at all, so they had no choice but to buy online. But for me, it's really quite interesting. And I'd be interested to see how much of that kind of increase will actually slip back once things get back to normal, whatever normal is. I don't even know what normal could be, but who knows? We'll see how that kind of plays out. So let's talk a little bit now about what some of the options you have around buying. So this is a horrible slide. It should look better, but what it would say is it should say it's all about machine learning. Again, please forgive me. This is the first time I'm importing a PowerPoint into Prezi, so I'll learn for the future. But it does say it's all about machine learning. This is a kind of video that I grabbed from YouTube of somebody driving a driverless car, and it goes down the freeway at about 75 miles an hour. Freaking me out, but obviously, you know, it's definitely machine learning is kind of the way that works, and that's clearly part of what, you know, programmatic media is all about. It's all about kind of algorithms and machine learning and AI, and in you being able to kind of do what you need to do kind of at scale. So again, if you look at sort of Google, I mean, Google has been around for a long time, probably since I think 2001. They launched their Google Ads product, and back then it was just plain vanilla keywords. Since then, it's kind of evolved, so it's no longer just search. You've got the Google Display Network, you've got shopping, you've got YouTube, you've got remarketing, right? But under kind of pinning all of those, there's a kind of an element of ad types or campaign types that are called smart campaigns, right? And really, what you're doing is you're letting Google take control of what goes on. So they're making a lot of the decisions, because in a lot of cases you have, you know, your data, and that's great, but Google has an awful lot of data that is other data with which they can kind of make informed decisions. So they can actually establish from the behavior that they know, right, what people are in market for a particular product. And if you happen to sell that product, then they can put your product in front of those people better than you would ever be able to do it if you didn't actually use the machine learning and the artificial intelligence that's available. If we look at Facebook, I mean, again, I know that a lot of people in the group are Facebook agencies. A lot of people are buying Facebook. For me, I kind of started to kind of do this on an iPad to just sort of try and illustrate the kind of complexity of Facebook and what it's all about. But if you look here, you can see we've got four sources. So kind of over there, you can see there are four sources of traffic. So Facebook, Instagram, Audience Network, and Messenger. You've got two buying types. So that's auction-based and reach and frequency. And then you have three types of campaign objectives. So you've got awareness, consideration, conversion, and those really sort of like translate into the top, middle, and bottom of the funnel, if a funnel is kind of what you use. So to go into the kind of the awareness side of things, so as I mentioned, there was sort of two types of things that you can do there, brand awareness and reach. In consideration, there's six types of campaigns that you can run. So you can run traffic, engagement, app installs, video views, lead generation, and messages. And then on the conversion side of things, you can obviously run for conversions. And with conversions, you can obviously do just purchases if you're an e-commerce business, but you can also do sort of micro conversions. And that could be things like newsletter signups, webinar signups, registrations, add to carts, initiate checkouts, those sorts of things. Those could be classed as sort of micro conversions. Then you've obviously got businesses that are trying to get people to go from sort of online to offline, so through store traffic, and then finally you've got sort of catalog sales. So on the campaign structure side of things, I mean, you know, I've taken all this information directly from Facebook, so this is not something that you shouldn't all know already, but again, For me, it's really just a case of you've obviously got the buying type, you've got your objective, you've got, you know, whether you use campaign budget optimization or not, you've got your budget, you've got the budget frequency, and again, you kind of go with a daily budget or do you go with a kind of lifetime budget. In terms of frequency, you know, like I said, it could be, you know, you decide to do day passing, you may well kind of want to go bid strategy and actually use one cost cap or you know, maximize whatever. So for me, it's really just a case of there's a lot of complexity in the campaign side of things. Then down onto the ad set side of things, you've got conversion event locations, and those are typically, you know, your Facebook page. So you might run a campaign for, you know, for kind of Facebook likes. You've also got conversions on your own website, you've got Messenger, and you've also got WhatsApp. So those are the four locations that you've got. Conversion events, so again, this is where you've got sort of 17 of those. Then you have the option of, within the ad sets, you know, are you going to use dynamic creative or not, right? And again, I always kind of suggest that the dynamic creative is probably one of the most underutilized tools that, that Facebook has, right? And I'll kind of explain why in a little bit. You've got your, obviously, your budget and schedule. So like I mentioned about that, you could kind of say, okay, well, I want this to run, you know, weekends. I want it to kind of run all the time. I don't want it to run in first thing in the morning. You can have audiences to include. You can have audiences to exclude. This could be people that have bought from you already. It could be people that have spent more than a certain amount of money, people that have bought multiple products, right? It could be people that buy one thing and then you upsell them into something else. So there's lots of ways in which you can kind of do things with audiences to try and get people to spend more money with you. Or it could also be if you only have one thing that you sell and you've got nothing else to sell, you can say, right, I want to exclude those people, but you can also create an audience that you can then use as a lookalike based upon the people in that particular audience of people that bought from you. So then when it comes to locations, again, you can obviously drill kind of super low on that. So again, as an example, the example I use quite often is if you're selling flip-flops, right, then somewhere like Alaska is less likely to be in market for flip-flops other than maybe a couple of months of the year, whereas in California, Hawaii, they're more likely to be in market for flip-flops all the time. Then you've obviously got age and gender. Again, we find we get great success when we split things out into ad sets and break it down into kind of logical age ranges. So that could be sort of 18 to 24, 25 to 34, 35 to 44, 45 to 54, 55 to 64, and 65 plus, right? Because they're all different. They all have different sort of requirements. And if we have those ad sets and we're using campaign budget optimization, we find that Facebook find a good way to get the money to the right ad set quickly, right? And that means it used to be we had to kind of do all that manually and it was kind of difficult to do, and we always find that we were left money on the table, whereas when we use CBO we can actually get great results by kind of splitting out the audience into the age and gender, right? So again, we can kind of go 18 to 24 females, 18 to 24 year old male, and we can actually find that we get better performance from that. And by doing it that way, we can have those sort of ad sets. We can potentially use different creative assets, even though sort of from a strategy perspective we're trying to talk to the whole population. When it comes to targeting, I mean, again, sort of with targeting, there's a lot that you can kind of do there. So again, we use like tools like Connectio to kind of give us the ability to kind of create audiences that we can then use for targeting purposes. We can, again, with languages, we tend to kind of leave that as it is, as in we don't put any languages in at all. Connections, so people, whether people are connected to your page or not. Placements, again, we automatically will always do all placements, right? I know a lot of people, they only do Facebook or they only do Instagram. All right, that's probably the only example where we wouldn't use all of them is if we were doing an Instagram story campaign with that in the ad, then obviously we wouldn't have all of them, but we would just have Instagram. But most of the time, we will run automatic placements and we'll let Facebook kind of work things out. And then when it comes to optimization, again, same thing. We try, ultimately, we want people to, if we're selling products and it's an e-commerce business, we want them to kind of get to conversions. We don't really want to optimize to add to carts. We don't want to optimize to initiate checkout. And although a lot of people talk about this, getting this sort of 50 conversions and everything else, for me, I always look at that as it's a little bit like Google suggesting to me that we need to spend $2 a click, right? It's like, that's kind of advisory. I think for me, I've got plenty of campaigns that I can sort of show you where we've got great results and we're not getting 50 conversions on a regular basis, but we're getting conversions that we're happy with. The CPA is okay. We're comfortable with it, right? So again, you're not penalized for it. It's just, you know, they try and sort of, by putting this learning limited, they make it sort of that you need to spend more money, put more in the budget or increase your bids. And if you're unable to do that, I mean, if you know your metrics and you know realistically you can't afford to spend more than $40 acquiring a sale, then don't spend more than $40 acquiring a sale, because you'll end up be out of business and Facebook won't care. They'll take your money regardless. Then obviously conversion rate. So we spent a lot of time on ad sets, and clearly I didn't get a lot of time to talk about this when I was presenting at the Digital Zone event, but I thought it would be useful for this particular group to kind of do that. And then when we come back to kind of ads, so you have the obviously the identity, the ad type, whether you use an existing post or not. Whether you, again, if you're using setting up your creative, you know, like do you kind of set them up dynamically so you can kind of go, right, okay, well, I'm going to use dynamic creative, right? And then what you're able to do is you're able to kind of mix and match lots of different assets. You can use images, videos, titles, descriptions, calls to action. And basically what that does is it really, really helps dramatically for your users not to end up with banner fatigue or ad fatigue. You just find that the ads can kind of run a lot more time without kind of starting to piss people off. So primary text, headlines, descriptions, URLs or events, if you're running something that could be, say, a webinar or something like that. You've got your display links, your call to actions, your language, and tracking. And I mean, I'm going to cover sort of tracking in more detail later on in another video. But for me, again, I'm stunned at how few advertisers take advantage of the dynamic value track parameters that Facebook has available to enable you to kind of push information into GA. Because what we find is quite often we're able to kind of start a journey on Facebook and pick up the conversation over in Google, knowing that they've got to a certain point in the conversation or the story that we're kind of trying to tell them on that platform. So it's really quite important to do that. So in summary, I mean, with Facebook, I can really summarize it with Power Five, right? That's it. That's all that matters for us is that kind of Power Five, right? And there's a link there that kind of talks you through what Power Five is. So let's talk about where the opportunities are, right? So this is something that I think is a fairly sort of a comfortable prediction that by the end of 2020, advertisers will probably spend about 2/3 of their display budget on native ads, right? Of one description or another. So native ads includes, I mean, people think of native ads as just your Taboolas and Outbrains, right? But if you think about it, Facebook ads primarily are native ads, right? Because ultimately, if you go, right, I'm using dynamic creative, right? You go, right, here's four images, here's five videos, four placements, four descriptions, right? And basically, Facebook will make up the ad on the fly. Same with Google with their smart campaigns, the responsive display ads and things like that, responsive search ads. You just give them the components and they will kind of make them up. So native ads, I think, you know, I think that's a sort of fairly confident prediction that a big chunk of it is going to be, you know, spent on native ads. I still think that the lowest hanging fruit for every single advertiser is remarketing, right? So for me, it's like, again, if you look in Google Analytics, normally if you kind of see new versus returning visitors are far more likely to convert, right? The conversion rate is normally double for us. What we see on new advertisers, we'll see a conversion rate of double that for returning. And for me, it's like, I'd rather kind of go with those returning people and try and get them over the line. So for us, I mean, a lot of people go, well, my audience is not on Snapchat or it's not on Pinterest. But for us, it's really easy to set up kind of like tracking and tagging on all of these platforms and use remarketing to kind of get people over the line. So in a lot of cases, we'll run Snapchat, we'll run Pinterest. We haven't run TikTok, and something that's kind of on our radar at the moment. But we've run sort of, like I said, Pinterest, we've run Snapchat, and really kind of running remarketing campaigns. And really, in a lot of cases, we just run remarketing campaigns because, you know, we don't really feel we need to kind of go too crazy on cold traffic with those channels. But, you know, that's not to say that they wouldn't be good, but it's just more of a, you know, for the clients that we work with, it's not been something that we wanted to kind of go too much into detail with. But certainly from a performance perspective, remarketing has been very good. And really, I mean, again, the beauty of using some of the platforms and channels that we have available is it's all about first party data, right? So ultimately, first party data is data that you own rather than you're getting it from a third party. So in our case, I mean, we use a kind of a platform. I know this is kind of hard to see. Let me see if I can put it on the screen here. Yeah. So if you look here, you can see that this is the kind of the back end of a platform that we use, and we're looking here at on-demand food delivery, right? So you can see here that we have access to about 12.8 million people where people have got apps like Grubhub, Uber Eats installed on their devices. But on the left-hand side, you can actually see that the IDFA, which is the iOS kind of identifier for people's mobile phones, that's gone. And that's obviously part of the most recent update that Apple came out with, right? But you can see up at the top right hand side that what we're doing is we're paying an override of a dollar CPM for us to be able to kind of drill in. So if we wanted to kind of layer on an on-demand food delivery audience, right, or run it just as a cold audience. So like if we said, okay, well, you know, this kind of audience that we have, right, is perfect for what we're after. So you can see here it's 58% female, right? And if we were targeting a 58, like an audience that was primarily female, we'd be okay with that, right? You can see down here we've got, you know, for things like, you know, for Walmart, people that shop at Walmart, we've got the potential to kind of add 1.5 million devices for that. Uber Eats, 5 million. Grubhub, 2 million. But yeah, so obviously from our perspective, that's clearly, you know, a lot of data that we have. And what we're able to do is we're able to kind of get people from these platforms, these sites, over to our site, and then once we get them on our site, we can cookie them. We can then put them into other kind of tactics that we've got going on to kind of get them over the line. So I'll just kind of bring this one up as well. So again, one of the things that people always talk about is they talk about, oh, you know, it's a shame that Facebook used to have all these fantastic audiences that you could kind of, you know, add as you know, a targeting. What we're able to do is with the platform that we use, which is called Centro, we're able to kind of like layer in the audiences that we want, right? So we can actually create an audience in Centro. So again, if we wanted to kind of create an audience specifically of women or specifically people that were conservative or, you know, Hispanic, Latino, you know, like huge, all these stuff that people used to do before we don't do now, right? We would be able to kind of like create an audience and then send it to Instagram and Facebook. We could send it to Snapchat. We could send it to Twitter. We could send it kind of like to Centro, which is obviously what we do currently. And what we find is we get great results from that. And like I said, it rather than us trying to build that audience up without kind of the targeting being that granular and spending $10, $15, $20 CPM, this costs us a dollar to kind of run that audience and get first party data through that method. And then just finally on this one, this is quite an interesting one. A lot of people are talking about, you know, cannabis advertising. So I know in Canada it's completely legal kind of nationally, and in the States it's kind of legal in several countries. In several states. And what we're able to kind of do, I mean, you can see here this is the kind of back end of our sort of Centro platform, and you can see here that some of these you know, platform deals have a huge amount of inventory. I mean, you can see that top one there. It's got run of exchange cannabis CBD for desktop, phone, and tablet. It's display traffic, and they had about 968 million impressions yesterday, right? So obviously there's a huge amount of traffic there. The next one is obviously video, 191. So there's a lot of inventory available for people that are involved or want to get involved in cannabis advertising. So for us, it's really just a case of, you know, we have access to a huge amount of data, right? Which then means that we're able to kind of be a little bit more clever in terms of the way we do what we do on the sort of campaign side of things. So let's talk a little bit about what some of the challenges are. So first off, it's definitely a more volatile auction model, right? So again, I've talked to many friends who almost like feel like jumping off a cliff because of the way Facebook is, right? Clearly at the moment there's an election going on, so that's where a lot of the money's being spent. But I think a lot of people are just kind of apathetic with it all. They're kind of bored with the pandemic. They just want it to end. They want to know what's going on for Christmas. They want to be able to go on vacation and they can't, right? So there's a lot of kind of volatility in the auctions as it stands at the moment. Cookies are going away, so I think a lot of people have relied on cookies to kind of give them kind of what they need, right? Clearly with things like the Facebook Pixel, that's okay, that's fine. Facebook knows if people are logged in on devices like mobiles and desktops, and they know because you're logged in they don't need a cookie for them to be able to know what you are. But what you'll probably start seeing is you'll start seeing in terms of some of the kind of the reporting when it comes to conversion, right? There may well be sort of situations where they start using probabilistic and deterministic mechanisms to actually decide whether a conversion has taken place. So they'll be able to say, you know, yep, fine, we know that that one has definitely taken place because we got a cookie. And they might say, well, this one started on a, you know, connected TV, right? So there's no cookie, there's no kind of click per se, but we know that that person saw the ad. So there's a probable, there's a high probability that that person actually converted. So yes, I think you'll start to see a lot less third-party data, right? So now is the time to kind of build up your own first-party data as much as you can, as you're able to. I think there's a definite lack of understanding of the options that you have available to you. People just assume that, you know, with Google, you know, you buy the Google Display Network through Google Ads and that's your lot, right? And the same with Facebook, you buy your audience ads through Facebook and that's your lot. Certainly with Google, I mean, Google has the, they have the sort of Google Display Network, right? But in the exchanges where we buy a lot of our media from Google, what we actually get is we get better quality traffic from them because the kind of stuff that finds its way onto the GDN is typically the remnant inventory that's not been sold on the exchanges. So we're finding that we're able to kind of buy higher up the kind of the auction, right? And what we're also able to do is if we identify a placement that we actually get great results from, right, we're able to kind of bid up on that particular placement. So in a lot of cases, the inventory never finds its way to the GDN. So for us, it's really just a case of, you know, trying to kind of drill into the data and again, leaning on the technology, the machine learning, the AI to kind of give us the data that we need to kind of do. There's definitely a lack of ad ops experience. So this is, again, the people that traffic the campaigns and set everything up. You know, the platform that we use, Centro, is very, very complicated to kind of use, right? So there's a distinct lack of ad ops expertise, right? It's not just a case of, you know, you log into Google Ads or Google Ads Manager or Facebook Business Manager. There's a lot of complexity to kind of what goes on. I think it's really important that, you know, certainly from my point of view, I'm trying to kind of encourage and hire more people to kind of do the ad op side of things, because I think it's definitely an area where there's a kind of a lack of people at this particular point in time. It's definitely hard to understand some of the performance metrics, because again, I think a lot of people are just assuming you spend money and you'll get click-through conversions and everything's wonderful in the world, right? But certainly on the programmatic side of things, you will find that there are a lot more view-through conversions. And also what you'll have is you'll have kind of some of the things you'll have to grapple with will be to do with things like viewable impressions. So if you take a page that might be, you know, I don't know, like really, really long, and there's a banner ad at the bottom, right? People may never scroll down to that banner, but you will still get charged for that placement. So what we're able to do is we're able to kind of buy below the fold or above the fold, right? So you might say, okay, well, if it's below the fold, we want to bid significantly lower. We actually might say, well, we want to exclude it completely, right? And that's certainly one of the things we've seen in Google Ads, that a lot of people have the option when they run display campaigns that they can exclude below the fold on display campaigns, but they never do, right? And that's probably one of those things where if you did that, that would probably save you quite a bit of money. So let's talk a little bit about what the ad types are available. So as I mentioned, like you've got native, you've got video, you've got connected TV, you've got rich media, and we'll talk about that in a second. We've got audio and we've got podcasts, and they might kind of really be kind of deemed to be the same. But sort of audio is more sort of advertising on audio platforms like Spotify, like SoundCloud, and then obviously podcasts. There's lots and lots, tons and tons more people listening to podcasts now than ever before. So again, there's clearly a big opportunity in podcast advertising. Very few people are doing it. And again, I think a lot of people assume that you need to have James Earl Jones or Morgan Freeman to actually do the voiceovers and create your videos and your audio and podcast ads, right? And that's not the case at all. I mean, you can get somebody on Fiverr to do it probably for like $20, and it'll be more than adequate for what you need. And then there's again, there's a huge amount of standard banners as well. Let's talk a little bit about some of the tools that are available. So these are some of the kind of almost like table stakes for us. So Centro is the platform that we use. We use Adocado, and I'll kind of got a couple of screenshots of that in a second. We use AdBeat for kind of competitor spying. We use AirTory, which is a kind of a rich media platform. And funny enough, I did a kind of a session with Julian Frackman, who's the CEO of AirTory, in the group a little while back. So you may well have sort of seen that. And then we use Bannersnack to actually create some of our standard banners in a kind of much more timely and efficient way. So this is Adocado. And in respect of Adocado, I mean, they give you the ability, if you're an e-commerce business and you're always going, hey, it'd be nice to kind of do dynamic marketing ads, but I don't really understand the complexities of it. What you can do is you can kind of upload your feed to Adocado, and they will enable you to kind of create your kind of, you know, your assets. So you just upload your product data with your name, the SKU, the price, the sale price, image and brand logo, and they will actually create banners for you of different sizes. They've also got different banners for different industries. So again, you can see here, this is the one for automotive. So let's look a little bit at AdBeat. So again, like with AdBeat, what it does is it gives you the ability to look at the back end of what ads your competitors or other people have been running. So obviously this is Shopify. I'm looking at Shopify running ads. We can see that obviously Shopify have had 736 ads this month, 7 fewer than last month. We can see that they've spent sort of 99% of their ads has been programmatic. We can see that 300 by 250 is probably the biggest size or the most common size for them. And then like on in terms of ad creatives, image ads is the kind of biggest format that they use, right? They've had 3,817 publishers that they've worked on. Then if we look at the types of ads, again, if you look here, you can see standard ads, and they're talking about 327 days is the longest running ad that they're running. And you might go, well, if they're running an ad for 327 days, that must be a fantastic ad. And it may well be, right? But quite often, it might be that they're just fools and they're running the same ad regardless. And then obviously the landing page is 641. So they've had a landing page that's been running for coming up on 2 years that's not actually sort of changed. So they don't spend like a ton of time creating new landing pages for the experience, which is fine, right? But again, it gives you the ability, you're able to kind of like drill in, you look at their ads, you can look at their native ads, video ads, landing pages, right? And you're able to kind of glean information from there as far as what sort of things work for other people, right? And also what sort of things you might want to kind of do to kind of compete. Then in terms of AirTory, so I'm not going to spend too much time on this because we did kind of go over that with Julian, but this just kind of shows you from a mobile ad perspective how many ad types there are. I mean, there's a insane number of ad types that they have, right? But the idea behind it is, with most people, when they run sort of display ads, they'll get like a really, really poor click-through rate. And obviously, if you're paying for your traffic on a CPM basis, right, then if you don't get clicks, then it becomes very expensive on a cost per click basis, right? And clearly, ultimately, people are looking for either kind of more first party data, or they're looking for conversions, right? Using interactive or rich media ads, right, you're able to kind of get people more involved in the actual ad itself, right? So they have a lot of like scratch to reveal, they have a lot of quizzes, carousels, they have all sorts of different types of ads that make that whole process that much better. So just in terms of the example, so this is a kind of an email capture ad format that they have, right? You can see on the right hand side there, you've got the asset properties in terms of what you need, right? In terms of the sizes, and then in terms of like copywriting, what sort of you need, headlines, call to action buttons, checkbox texts, and all that sort of stuff. And then there's a link at the bottom there to the presentation that Julian and I did a little while back. Yeah, so this kind of just shows you in a little bit more detail. So yes, if you haven't seen that video already, just take a screenshot of that and watch it at your leisure. And then finally, this is Banner Snack. So Banner Snack is one of those things, again, we kind of came across it, and it became, we found that creating banners for clients was one of the biggest challenges we had as an agency. Yes, we could kind of go and hire people from the Philippines, and we did that, right? But in a lot of cases, what we wanted to do was to find a kind of cheap and dirty way of kind of creating ads quickly, so we could kind of test hypotheses out before we actually spent a lot of time, effort, and money building kind of better looking banners. So this kind of tool is comparatively cheap for us, and it's obviously compliant and compatible with IAB, Google Ads, Facebook Ads, right? So we can kind of create ads pretty quickly using this platform. So that was kind of what we were going to cover. So, and then obviously this was how people could contact me. I know that obviously everyone in the group knows who I am, but if you haven't kind of got my details, there they are. Contact me on Twitter, Facebook. If you haven't joined the elitemediabuyers.com forum, go to that URL, sign up. It's free to join. I'd love to kind of have you over there. I'm trying to kind of build more content over there. Not because I kind of want to desert the Facebook group, but I just find sometimes if you want to say something controversial about Facebook, right, saying it on Facebook is not the best place to do that. So it just gives us the opportunity to kind of do that kind of elsewhere. And that's the end of my presentation. I would love to know kind of what you thought. So please leave me comments and let me know what you thought, good, bad, or indifferent. And I look forward to making the next video for you. All right. And for the purposes of YouTube, if you haven't already subscribed to the channel, please subscribe to my channel. And I will talk to you at some point in time soon. Take care. Bye for now.